There has never been, since the creation of Adam and Eve, a more epic convergence of Bible prophecy unfold than in our generation. And now, as the world moves forward in an unprecedented fashion, leaders from around the world will proclaim, with boldness, peace and security. But just as Jesus warned the world, sudden destruction shall fall upon them as a woman in travail, and they shall not escape. The question is not a matter of if, but when. Are you ready to meet Christ in the air? Or will you be left behind to suffer through the great tribulation period? Jesus is coming back much sooner than you believe. Get the facts. Find Christ and get saved right here on Prophecies of the End Times Radio Ministry. And now, coming to you live from studios in Coldwater, Michigan, here is your host, evangelist and Bible prophecy teacher, Michael Parker.
Hey, welcome to this edition of Prophecies of the End Times Radio Ministry. Doing our show today on You're an Overcomer on Spreaker. Hey, thanks for tuning in. Yeah, life in the fast lane. Today's message is all about drugs, alcohol, perversion, sexual addictions. And we're going to be talking to you about how these things are given unto those who are cursed and have generational curses and the addictions that they have and the strongholds that are in their life and how they can have victory in Christ Jesus. So stay with me. I'll be right back here in just a few minutes.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice at the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. Feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, oh, he's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you feel lost, well, he's a waymaker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. Oh, if you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, well, he's a chain breaker.
That was the only way I know of how you could be completely healed of your addictions to marijuana, your addictions to drugs, alcohol, perversion of sexual immorality, your addictions to of evil. And it was the only way I knew. So welcome to the podcast. It was the only way I knew, through Jesus, to break the chains, to get rid of those things out of my life. You know, I was a 27-year veteran alcoholic for a major portion of my life, and drugs had a huge hold on me, and alcohol had a huge hold on me, 27 years. So I feel that I've got an anointing for this message, and I feel strongly that I've got enough experience to reach out to those of you who may compromise in your principles for the way you live your life and the things that you do, to be able to bring a message to you today and bring it with the facts regarding Scripture and the facts regarding your own blindness, your own misfortunes, your own compromises you have in life if you proclaim to be a Christian and you're doing these things. So I want you to listen up carefully. Some of y'all are going to get your toes stepped on, just like I did when I was going through these things. And so you have to listen up and open up your mind and open up your heart and be sober in mind and heart as we bring you this message today. Now, I want to start off with some facts. You know, the history of illegal drugs in America really goes back nearly an entire century in this country. And it may be surprising, and to some of you, that many of these illegal drugs basically were first introduced by doctors as legal over-the-counter and prescription medications. And we're speaking about drugs in the very beginning of this message, because that's where, from there, we'll go to alcohol and we'll go to other things too. It was introduced by doctors, legal over-the-counter and prescription medications, I'm just going to highlight you on tell you about how the history behind some of the drugs that are more popular today in our culture and our society. First, let's go in with marijuana. Now, some of you have posted on Facebook this morning on our Facebook page at Prophecies of the End Times. Some folks have posted their opinions. I think one person posted, you know, hey, I'm beginning to evolve, basically, about medicinal marijuana and its effects and the good things that it can do. I posted a video, world's biggest open marijuana market, 420 in Vancouver, Canada, about 30 minutes long, of a medicinal guy, the 420 weed guy, who is a medicinal marijuana dealer. And, of course, Vancouver, back in, I believe, several years ago, was in 2012 or 2011 when they legalized marijuana in that country. This was a flea market where you could just go and buy marijuana in the video. It's posted on our Facebook page. So one of the oldest drugs in American history here is marijuana. And it's probably for much so like that all throughout the world. Marijuana, which was grown by the Jamestown settlers around 1600. So before the Civil War, marijuana was a major source of revenue for the United States, and marijuana plantations flourished during the 19th century. Marijuana was widely used as a medicinal drug from 1850 to 1937. It could even be purchased over-the-counter in pharmacies and general stores. Did any of you know that? Marijuana became an attractive alternative to alcohol after the price of alcohol was raised in 1920. So many of you probably didn't know the history of weed, and it was back in the day when your daddies, I'm 57, my dad and his daddies were back in the day when, and of course many of you have heard me talk about our heritage, the Parker heritage. We came from England, and we arrived here in the United States in 1605. So maybe part of my heritage, and this is why I get tore up over this stuff, guys, and I'll be tore up today. It's part of my heritage brought this stuff here. In the 1930s, studies began to emerge that linked marijuana use by lower-class communities to crime and violence, leading to the eventual banning of marijuana in 1937. In the 60s, marijuana use became a popular drug of choice among the white beatniks, and stricter penalties for marijuana offenses were passed under the Comprehensive Drug Abuse Prevention and Control Act of 1970. Since then, citizens and politicians alike have pushed to have marijuana decriminalized, but it remains an illegal drug in portions of the U.S. Now, of course, since this article was written just 4 years ago, we have legalization of marijuana and the reduction of its criminalization in 24 states. We have 14 more states by the end of 2016, which will more than likely legalize marijuana. So marijuana has, however, legalized for medical use in California in 1966 for people with serious illness, and medical marijuana still remains legal in some states, now, of course, in California. And as you see in the 420 video, there's things that are like that. They're popping up in Colorado. It's all over the country. Now, it's still, what's really amazing is that yesterday, Friday, the DEA, the Department of the DEA, the Drug Enforcement Agency, they decided not to classify marijuana, and they've left it open for some reason. And many pundits in Congress and the congressmen and the people in the states are applauding because they know what's coming next. It's going to be more than likely introduced to the Supreme Court justices, and it's going to be decriminalized and made legal nationwide. And so the federal government will recognize it as being a certain level of marijuana being used and or in possession of, and it'll be decriminalized. The states will follow, because right now states have decriminalized it to a point. Some of them have decriminalized it to a point to where it's just a $100 fine. If you're carrying, I think it's 18 or 28 grams of marijuana in California, it's a $100 fine or less. So what happens here? I'll get back to that. I don't want to get ahead of myself. I want to be able to continue on and set the foundation for this. History of methamphetamine in America. The stimulant methamphetamine first became popular in the medical community in the 1920s, where it was used for stimulating the central nervous system, raising blood pressure, and enlarging nasal passages. Methamphetamines were widely distributed to soldiers during World War II to combat fatigue and improve endurance and mood, and were prescribed by doctors after the war to help fight depression. Methamphetamine's abuse began during the 30s when it became an over-the-counter inhalant drug marketed under the name Benzedrine. As more and more people legally used methamphetamines, an illegal black market began to emerge. Illegal methamphetamines were used commonly by truck drivers who wanted to stay alert on long commutes, and athletes looking for to improve their performance. Students also began taking illicit methamphetamines to help them study. The practice of injecting amphetamines gained popularity in the 1960s, which led the emergence of underground labs that were mainly controlled by outlaw motorcycle groups. During the 70s, amphetamines use began to decline due to the increased public awareness of its dangers, and remained in on decline until the 1990s when crystal methamphetamine, a smokable form of methamphetamine, emerged. Since then, crystal meth has remained a popular drug of choice for three main types of users: high school and college students, blue-collar Caucasians, and unemployed persons in their 20s and 30s. But here in Michigan, in the county that I live, Branch County, Michigan, and St. Joe County, Michigan, those two counties, out of all the counties in the state of Michigan, have a drug epidemic of methamphetamine. And it's unbelievable. The cops don't mess with people when it comes to marijuana. They mess with the meth heads, the people who are on meth. History of cocaine in America. Now, this one hits home pretty hard with me. I was a cocaine addict back in the 80s. Cocaine was a popular medical drug in Europe for decades before it became popular in America. In 1886, Coca-Cola was introduced and contained syrup derived from cocoa leaves. That same year, the Surgeon General of the United States Army endorsed medical use of cocaine. Over the next few decades, various unregulated medicinal tonics were sold in the U.S. containing cocaine, and hundreds of Hollywood silent movies depicted scenes of cocaine use. By 1902, there were an estimated 200,000 cocaine addicts in the U.S. Now listen, what did I just say? By 1902. Cocaine was finally outlawed in 1914 and declined in usage over the decades until it regained popularity in the 1970s as a recreational glamorized drug, eventually reaching its peak in 1982 with 10.4 million users. Some U.S. media declared cocaine as non-addictive, and it was viewed as a relatively harmless drug until the emergence of crack cocaine in 1985. The history of crack cocaine in America, crack, a form of cocaine that is sold as rocks and smoked, first appeared in large U.S. cities around 1985. Crack became a popular alternative to cocaine in urban and working class areas because it was much cheaper than cocaine. This led to a dramatic increase in crack use known as the crack epidemic of the 1980s. Major crackdown on crack abuse was launched, leading to its eventual decline in usage. Then we go to the history of LSD. That's right, LSD was a legal drug at one time. This blows me away. LSD first emerged on the American scene during the 1950s when the U.S. military and CIA researched the use of LSD as a truth drug that could be used to make persons talk. This led to the psychiatric community to become interested in LSD for its possible therapeutic capabilities for depressed, psychotic, and epileptic patients. Illegal use of LSD began to escalate during the late 50s and 60s as mental health professionals, research study participants began to distribute the drug among their friends. LSD was only available through connections to the medical field until 1962, when a black market for LSD emerged in America. LSD was made illegal in 1966, and soon after an LSD black market emerged. Users began experiencing growing problems with the new LSD, which was contaminated and of a poorer quality than the medical-grade LSD that they were used to using. Despite its poor quality, LSD was a popular drug of choice for the hippies during the mid to late 60s. LSD use declined in the 70s and the 80s, but reemerged in the 1990s in the rave subculture along with other hallucinogens. And then here's another one. History of heroin in America. Opiates were popular in the United States throughout the 19th century, particularly among upper and middle class women who were prescribed tonics and elixirs containing opium to cure female problems. The practice of smoking opium was introduced in the 1850s and 1860s by Chinese laborers who came to the U.S. to work on railroads. The opiate-based drug, morphine, was created in 1803 and widely used during the American Civil War as an injectable pain reliever, leading to the first wave of morphine addictions. Interestingly, the drug heroin was created in 1895 and marketed 3 years later as a potential solution to the increasing problem of morphine addiction. The charitable St. James Society even mailed free samples of heroin to morphine addicts as part of a campaign against morphine addiction. And as a result, heroin addiction began to take root and grow. The second major wave of opiate addiction in America began in the 1930s and the 1940s, Harlem jazz scene, and again during the beatnik subculture of the 50s. During the Vietnam War, heroin abuse became rampant among U.S. soldiers stationed abroad, with an estimated 10% to 15% of servicemen addicted to heroin. Heroin users began smoking and snorting heroin after improvements were made in the purity of street heroin in the 1980s and 1990s, and as a result, heroin usage rose significantly in the 1990s. And it's now an epidemic amongst young people, and we're not talking, you know, poverty-stricken, we're talking blue-collar also. It's an epidemic in this country. So there's a little bit of the foundation, first of all, of the fact of why, you know, what the drugs we're going to talk about and how these drugs work on people and what happens to us according to Scripture when we take them, all right? We'll get to alcohol here in the second half of our podcast. So what does Scripture say about all this? All right, where do we weigh in on this? All right, Let's soften the blow a little bit here, all right? Let's talk about what Christians should think or do when it comes to marijuana. Should Christians smoke medical marijuana? And we're going to weigh in on the pot morality of this. Now, a gentleman who writes an article, his name is Brett McCracken. He's the author of Hipster Christianity, When Church and Cool Collide. He writes about pop culture for Revelant magazine and also Christianity Today magazine. Now, this was his article and his take on medical marijuana, medicinal marijuana. And he says, medical marijuana is certainly helpful for people in great pain, many of whom use the drug in the same way they would use a pain reliever like codeine. The difference between codeine and cannabis is that the latter has a very distinct, largely negative image in culture, an image that carries baggage and connotations Christians must consider if they're thinking of using marijuana even for medical reasons. He continues on and says, when I was in grad school, several of my colleagues smoked marijuana. I do not doubt that smoking marijuana relieved the aches and pains of my 20-something cohorts, but I wonder if medical assistance is the primary reason they were using it. More likely, they consumed it in a way Oscar on Arrested Development did, enjoying primo bud under the auspices of the legal right of medical marijuana. In California, the image of marijuana use, even for medical purposes, is mostly a joke. Pot smoking has long been associated with slackers, zoned out, disengaged, pleasure-seeking rebels, always in search of a high. The image has even given rise to a genre of cinema, you know, the stoner films. The image of those who smoke weed in these films is one of laziness, irresponsibility, and mischief. The image of medical marijuana is not much better. Walk down the Venice or Santa Monica boardwalk in Los Angeles and you will be bombarded with leaflets for dozens of medical marijuana dispensaries in town. The fallible hippies even call out, get your medical marijuana recommendation here. The dispensaries are more like recreational amusement shops than clinics for the sick. And the overall culture is one of, here's a sweet loophole, partying more than anything else. Given these connotations, Christians should be cautious about using marijuana. Marijuana is associated with vice and unseemly activity. Christians are called to be above reproach, without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, shining as lights in the world, according to Philippians chapter 2, verse 15. We are told to not to be conformed of this world, Romans chapter 12, verse 2, and to walk properly as in the daytime, avoiding sins of addiction such as drinking and partying, Romans chapter 13, verse 13. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 and 12, Peter urges Christians to abstain from the passions of the flesh and to keep their conduct honorable so unbelievers may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. The issue is not the relative danger of marijuana itself. It is about witness. And, you know, I'm going to stop right there and kind of give you a little bit of a message with this. Look, you know, there's no argument where scientists have proven and can prove that medical marijuana may be good for some people. Now, I recall my aunt Gloria Larson, and many, many years ago, she passed away, and she was receiving chemotherapy. And the only thing that would keep her from throwing up was a last-ditch effort. She wanted to tell, she told my mother, she said, what about marijuana? Now, my mom was a devout Christian, and my Aunt Gloria lived with my mom. And she was dying. She had lymph node cancer. And she was getting her chemotherapy treatment and had gone so far that chemo was pretty aggressive. She couldn't eat. And so they found a person, and this has been many years ago, there was no medical marijuana dispensaries anywhere. They found a person where she could get marijuana, and she gave it a try. She tried to see if it would keep her from throwing up and so that she could eat. And it did. It worked for a while. So, you know, did my aunt go to hell because she smoked marijuana because she was dying of cancer? No. So she did it in her home. She wasn't out partying with people. She did it with in my mother's home. She wasn't out partying with people. She wasn't out trying to get people to smoke marijuana to have a good time. She wasn't out doing things that she shouldn't be doing. And so then there, my mind goes back to that. And I ask myself, you know, how am I supposed to evolve over this? What am I supposed to think? Because I'm an evangelist. I'm on my way of becoming a pastor and to be able to pastor a church. And what am I supposed to think about this? We need to draw the line, first of all, okay? Draw the line. Number one, if you have no ability within yourself to stay away from this stuff, then you best be on your knees before God, crying out to Him to give you the power and the strength so you can stay away from it. If you have a medical condition, your first onset of what you need to do is to reach out to God for your healing. Reach out to God and depend upon God for your healing. Depend upon Him that He can heal you. And He can heal you without medical marijuana or without marijuana in your life. Okay? But it comes down to the individual. It comes down to the individual's decision. And when we, and because if we do not research our heritage, if we do not research where we come from, if we don't know our family history tree, I suggest strongly you don't even put it to your lips. You don't touch it. You need to find out what generational curses that were passed along to you by your four generational fathers before you even attempt to do anything like that. And we're going to get into that here in just a few minutes. So if Christians use marijuana as a medical aid, it should be done in the quiet, private manner without flaunting. Christians must be mindful of pot's controversial and hazardous reputation and culture and be sensitive to the perspectives of both other Christians and unbelieving observers. Christians should take note that the food offered to idols issue in 1 Corinthians chapter 8 through 10 and strive to abstain from arguably innocuous activities that are nevertheless contested in culture. In other words, you got to be conscientious about what you're doing because it's not worth offending or making someone stumble, see? And so if I have in this 420 video this guy walking around buying marijuana in an open market, you know, these guys giving the devil sign with their hands, they're not Christians. But it's medicinal marijuana. Well, he goes up and he buys the pot and he says, hey, look, you know, I had a bone marrow transplant. So he smokes the marijuana for what? The pain? Obviously. Who am I to judge in reference to what he's doing? But the appearance that if this man was a professing Christian, how many people were there who said, you know what, I've never smoked pot before, and I can buy it freely here. I wonder for recreational use. Well, here's a man who says he's a Christian, and he's buying it, and he says it's okay. And so then, therefore, you may cause a brother or a sister to stumble, to become addicted to something that opens the portal to demonic influence into their life. You caused that. You, by what you said or did. And so if you use medical marijuana, if you decide to use it as a last ditch effort of having something in your life that helps take away the pain, you don't have enough faith in God to do it for you, and you decide to make the decision to smoke medical marijuana, well, that's your choice. But you know what? You need to do it in your home. And you need to stay in your home and do it in your home. And then I would suggest strongly that you are on your knees on a daily basis asking God to heal you of your ailment and to take the marijuana away. And then make the decision to give it up completely. So what happens when we open up our mind and the portals of our mind to drug use? What's Scripture say about these things? And so now we're gonna change gears a little bit. Dr. David Stewart, who is the utmost authority on demonology, writes this. The Bible, God's inspired words, say much about demons that are influenced by drug use. It says this in Matthew chapter 12, verses 43 through 45. When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places seeking rest, and findeth none. Then he saith, I will return unto my house from whence I came out. And when he's come, he findeth it empty, swept, and garnished. Then goeth he and taketh with himself seven other spirits more wicked than himself. And they enter in and dwell there. And in the last state of that man is worse than the first. Even so shall it be also unto this wicked generation. This is truly, folks, an amazing passage here of Scripture. This talks about why do demons walk in dry places? It's because that's where humans live. It's evident that these scriptures that are there are more demon. There's more demons than victims. For the Bible says this demon had a difficult time finding a body to possess. Thus we see the vulnerability here of those who open themselves up to demonic possession. And there's demons waiting in line to move into the body of those who are unsaved and vulnerable, those who are possessed by their addictions of drugs and alcohol, sexual immorality. And one of the most common avenues of demon possession is alcohol and drug abuse. In fact, the Old Testament Hebrew word for sorcerer is the same root word from which we get the modern term pharmacy, also in the Greek, pharmaceia. Demons, drugs, and alcohol are synonymous. Just ask any woman who's ever been addicted to heroin or cocaine, then she prostitutes herself for a few dollars a night to support a drug addiction habit. Only they can testify as to the demonic powers they witness before their eyes and the power of Satan over their life. But the answer is not rehabilitation, reformation, nor education, but regeneration through faith in Christ Jesus. Acts chapter 26, verse 18. To open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Carefully notice here also in Matthew chapter 12 verses 44 and 45 what the Bible teaches concerning demonic possession, the futility of rehabilitation, and enslavement to sin. And I quote, Jesus saying in Matthew chapter 12, verses 44 and 45, then he saith, I will return into my house from whence I came out. And when he is come, he findeth it empty, swept, and garnished. Then goeth he and taketh with himself seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first. Even so shall it be unto this wicked generation. And so in this Bible verse, we're going to present several biblical truths here. First, an unsaved person who is ignorant of the scriptures and worldly is vulnerable to Satan. The Bible says the demon came back to the struggling addict and found his soul empty. The Holy Spirit of God lives within the body of the believer, and so it is not empty. The first step to overcoming addiction and demon possession and oppression is to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as one Savior from the curse and the stronghold of that sin. Secondly, the Bible says that the demon came back to the struggling addict and found his soul swept. So this is education, reformation, and rehabilitation, which cannot substitute regeneration, being born again. The Word of God is the sword by which we can defeat Satan in our lives, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17. And the Word of God is the seed by which we are born again, 1 Peter 1:23. The Bible says the demon came back to the struggling addict and found his soul garnished. The demon comes back and finds his former dwelling place decorated and ready to move in. This is worldliness. The person whose soul loves the sinful world is a demon's delight. Now, second, the demon brings additional spirits with him that are more wicked than himself. So the result of that is that some demons are more wicked than others. Evidently, the first demon was upset that he was evicted, which is the addict trying to clean up their life. And now the demon wants to reclaim his territory with a vengeance. And by bringing more demons, it'd be much harder to break the addiction, which is exactly what the Bible teaches. And the last state of that man is worse than the first. This is addiction to sin, enslavement, bondage. 2 Peter 2:19, for whom a man is overcome, of the same he is brought in bondage. And so then demons often return to their former victims. You and I, if we're a born-again believer, I'm a victim of alcoholism and drug abuse. It is important to understand that once a person has had demons in their life, those demons will target that person and keep coming back until that soul is delivered by the transforming power of the gospel and obedience to the word of God. I'll read it again. It is important to understand that once a person has had demons in their life, those demons will target that person and keep coming back until that soul is delivered by the transforming power of the gospel and the obedience to the word of God. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 43, demons get frustrated. When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest and finding none. The Bible doesn't mean physical rest for demons from labor, but rather the containment or the contentment that a demon finds from having a home, a human body to dwell in. Just as every person desires to have a place to call home, so it is with demons. A demon without a human body to dwell is like a bird without a nest or a fox without a hole. It's very interesting and evil that the author of The Golden Compass portrays children in the movie as being sick because they've lost their demon. The word demon is mentioned over 50 times throughout this children's movie. It's just utter evil. Many books have been written concerning demons in the Bible. As believers, we shouldn't fear demons, but rather God who reigns supreme over the universe. Satan is a defeated foe, being and his days are numbered. However, the unsaved are greatly at risk for demon possession. Acts chapter 19, verse 14 through 16. And there were seven sons of one Sceva, a Jew and chief of the priests, which did so. And the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are ye? And the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on, them and overcame them and prevailed against them, so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded. Now notice that the young men ended up naked and wounded. Nudity, insanity, masochism, sadism, and transgendered tendencies are all inherent of demonism. We hear of many young people these days self-mutilating themselves, piercing various different body parts, including their genitals, receiving tattoos from head to toe, and scarring of the body as a form of so-called art, which is, you know, scarification. It's demonic in nature. So demons are evil spirits. Revelation chapter 16, verse 13 and 14, we will be there shortly. In our study, it starts at 7 p.m. tonight, Revelation chapter 4, chapter 5. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of a dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. For they are the spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world, to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. Notice here in Revelation chapter 16, what I just read, verses 13 and 14, the devil's imitation of the Godhead. The Bible mentions the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. An evil spirit, which is a demon, proceeds forth from each of these to gather the wicked kings of the earth to the battle of Armageddon. This battle concludes the tribulation period when the Lord returns to put down the Antichrist and the false prophet and the dragon. So there is a demonic attack happening today across America. Demonic influences absolutely saturate American society, from homosexual Hollywood to Sin City, Las Vegas. Demonic scripts influence people through lust on television and also through fleshy rock and roll music that stirs the flesh and hardens the soul. Rock music and TV diminish the awfulness of sin. American culture idolizes the music. I mean, it's a shame to hear a high school orchestra playing different types of demonic music. Demons look for human weakness and vulnerability. Alcohol and drugs are popular mediums through which demons, evil spirits, are able to infiltrate a person's soul and corrupt their behavior. Some of the most heinous crimes ever committed were done by drunkards. My friend, You can't take two drinks if you don't take the first. That's good advice for young people. The philosophy of not drinking and driving is insane. The truth is that there is no law in America against drinking and driving. The law only punishes alcoholics if their blood alcohol content is higher than 0.08. Most companies fire an employee at 0.01. Yet America's corrupt legal system allows drivers on the road at 0.06 and 0.07, legally. Many deadly accidents involved alcohol-impaired drivers which do not exceed the 0.08 blood alcohol level. So demons love beer drinkers. Let's talk about some folks here in the past. Remember Michael Jackson? Michael Jackson did to himself, what he did to himself is nothing less than demonic. Michael Jackson was and is idolized still by his fans as a singing god. Not surprisingly, Jackson's music is highly favored amongst gay, lesbian, and transgendered and bisexual people worldwide. Jackson's life and career went from being that of a popular young black entertainer to a nightmarish freak show. Lisa Marie Presley stated on her MySpace page after Jackson's death that during their marriage, Michael saw awful vampires and leeches around her. Now, I'm not trying to be unkind here in any way, truly, but Satan wants to destroy all of us. Jesus even told Peter, one of his apostles, that Satan hath desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat, Luke chapter 22, verse 31. Saved or unsaved, Satan wants to have you and destroy your life. If you're saved, he wants you even more than the unsaved. A common denominator between the occult, witchcraft, which is either Celtic or Wiccan, and Satanism, are sexual sins and nudity. Peter's fishing, naked, and then he saw Jesus. He immediately grabbed his fisherman's coat and jumped into the sea. This is found in John 21, chapter 21, verse 7, the book of John. Jesus is the cure for nudity. Luke chapter 8, 35, then they went out to see what was done and came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the devils were departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. See, Jesus had cast the demons out of the man into the pigs that ran off the cliff. And the man that was naked was now clothed. Even those possessed of demons come into their right mind when they trustingly sit at the feet of Jesus, their Savior. There is no demonic power on earth that can prevent the salvation of a soul or the mending of a broken man while childlike faith is present in Christ Jesus. 1 John 4:4 teaches, ye are of God, little children, have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. That scripture is only true concerning the saved believer, whose sins have been taken away by the precious blood of Christ. And although a born-again Christian cannot be demon-possessed, so to speak, they can be demon-influenced and demon-oppressed. A demon cannot reside in the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is the body of the believer, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. However, Christians who dabble in rock and roll music, fornication, pornography, alcohol, drugs, they open themselves up to demonic influences and oppression. Now, what about demons in the entertainment industry? Done some extensive research on that. You can go to Prophecies of the End Times on Spreaker. Go to our website and research our podcasts. You'll find that we've got dozens of excellent resources and podcasts on this. Demons in the entertainment industry is pretty disturbing. And what's even more disturbing is that many Christians are naive concerning the demonic influences that some of the devil's children openly admit. Listen to this. How many of y'all know Carlos Santana? He admits to having his own personal demonic god. This was written in Rolling Stone magazine. He calls his god Metatron. Here's a disturbing excerpt from Rolling Stone magazine. Carlos says Metatron is an angel. Santana has been in regular contact with him since 1994. Carlos will sit here facing the wall with the candles lit. He has a yellow legal pad at one side ready for the communications that will come. It's kind of like a fax machine, he says. Now, this was the cover story of the epic life of Carlos Santana, Rolling Stone, March 16th, year 2000. So by his own words, Santana admits to having communications with a demon named Metatron. Demons don't usually make people jump into fires or run nude down the street. Most often, demonic influences lead people into sin, which destroys the person's life. But in some cases, demons can cause a person like Hitler to murder millions of innocent people. Hitler was deeply involved in the occult. Certainly, there is a demonic spirit behind the abortion industry, who sells the parts of aborted babies for a profit. In fact, elite women are paying thousands of dollars for beauty treatments made from aborted fetuses. Aborted fetuses from girls and young women are being exported from Ukraine for use in illegal beauty treatments costing thousands of pounds and thousands of dollars in the UK. That's Satan at work. It was demonic possession which influenced Herod to murder thousands of babies in an attempt to kill the Lord Jesus Christ. Our society today is saturated with demonic influences. When Peter tried to prevent Jesus from going to the cross, Jesus called him Satan. Jesus said that Judas was a devil in John 6:70. Demonology isn't just some cute doctrine that's interesting. Demons are literal spirit beings, malicious and malignant in every way, showing mankind no mercy, no love, and no concern. And then we got Hollywood. Now, Hollywood's a demonic-inspired cesspool of iniquity. Demons are evil. There are no good demons, which is why they are called devils. Yet we got Hollywood producing television shows called Lucifer. It's okay to hang out with the devil. What is it that makes men so evil? It's the wicked sin nature of man. That's exactly what it is. It's us and our flesh. Jeremiah 17:9. But when men sell out to do evil, demons will guide them via occult influences, worldly philosophies, false religion, and other means. Let's talk about a little bit of that occult. Remember Nancy Reagan, the wife of U.S. President Ronald Reagan? She brought psychics and seances into the White House, as did Eleanor Roosevelt, Hillary Clinton, and Abraham Lincoln's wife. These are demonic powers that invite the devil into one's life. It's been told on many news publications that Hillary Clinton's been channeling Eleanor Roosevelt to get advice from her. There are only two sources of spiritual guidance, power, and wisdom: God or Satan. So it's easy to identify Satan at work, because any spirit that is not the Holy Spirit is a familiar spirit, a demon. You know, a book could be written concerning demonic influences among celebrities, the wealthy, and the famous. There's thousands of stories that are out there. People could tell you. A book would be, you'd take you years to read it, of what's been going on. And we look at what Satan did. Satan offered Jesus worldly prosperity in exchange for worship. But the Lord refused and quoted the Bible to defeat the devil, Matthew chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. So it seems that everyone these days has taken Satan up on his offer. The Bible confirms that this evil world's god is the devil, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. But the earth itself and everything therein belongs to the Lord, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 26. So God owns the land, God owns the trees, God owns the rivers, and when men destroy the earth, they are destroying God's property. And you know what? He's kind of upset about it, folks. We'll get to that in Revelation in our study. Demonic spirits are prevalent in the music industry. Very prevalent. So this includes everything from rock music and country to contemporary, even Christian rock music. Sexual immorality, lasciviousness, lesbianism, and lewdness are epidemic throughout the music industry's videos. Demons are spirits and influence the spirit of humans. So Only man has a soul and spirit, created after the likeness of God. Man's spirit gives him the ability for intelligence and art and love and forgiveness, whereas, you know, like animals, only have these basic impulses and primitive thought processes. Now, Hollywood has a satanic agenda. There's a documentary that exposes the occult roots of Hollywood. It's about an hour and a half long, and it's called Hollywood's Satanic Agenda. You should look at it. It's on YouTube. Many secular singers, actors, and musicians have testified of familiar spirits and powers that shaped their performance. Robert Plant of Led Zeppelin claims that he penned Stairway to Heaven in just 15 minutes by some external force. Ozzy Osbourne has attributed his work to Satan. AC/DC's Angus Young has testified to demonic powers that control his guitar playing in concert. So Satan is, it's real. And these things are influenced, and I'm telling you about, by drugs and alcohol. These things come into your life when you're addicted to drugs and alcohol. And these things I'm speaking of are the familiar spirits. So Satan has a kingdom. His kingdom is a hierarchy of structured power here on earth. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, Paul says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." The Bible instructs Christians that our battle in this world is not against flesh and blood. Very few Christians live like they believe this is true, though. And to the same degree that you are concerned about lost souls and trying to get people saved, to that same degree you truly believe that hell exists and that we wrestle against the forces of Satan. You need to believe it. Demons are under the orders from the prince of the power of the air, who is Satan. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2, "Where in the time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience." Now, the children of disobedience are all Christ rejectors, those people who have not obeyed the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9 also refer to this. And it also refers to demonic forces that operate through occult organizations. There are symbols that are very important to occultists and will play a major role in the realm of the Antichrist, just as Nebuchadnezzar's golden image did in his kingdom at Babylon. So why Satan? Why Satan? Satan is the father of every unsaved person. And we can often refer to unsaved people as the children of the devil. Christ did. He looked at a group of crowd of people who said that they said that he was the Messiah. And he looked at them and he says, "You are of your father, the devil," because he knew that they were trying to conspire to kill him. So this means that they are spiritually dead and therefore are susceptible to Satan's spiritual guidance and influence. Few people understand that the human spirit is highly vulnerable to spiritual influences, such as movies, music, books, magazines, doctrines. Everything detected through the five senses, such as sight, hearing, taste, feel, and smell. Man is created in God's image. Just as the Godhead is triune in nature, so also is mankind. The spirit returns to God who gave it at death, Ecclesiastes 12:7. The soul is a heart to feel, a mind to think, and a will to decide. And then the body is the tabernacle of the soul and the spirit, 2 Corinthians 5:1. So our spirit is who we really are inside. An unsaved person is spiritually dead by birth. You know, note that spiritual death is not the same as the second death found in Revelation 21, verse 8. The second death is the lake of fire forever. Every human being is born spiritually dead and inherited to sin nature from Adam, Romans chapter 5, verse 12. The Bible calls this the natural man, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. "But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. This is why unsaved people cannot understand the Bible. This is why if you studied the Bible without the presence of the author, God himself, you're 100% guaranteed to misinterpret the scriptures and teach heresy. Everyone needs to get saved so you understand the Word of God. Romans chapter 8, verse 9, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Every Christian believer has the Holy Spirit living and dwelling within their body. If you don't have God's Spirit in you, then you are not saved. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 6 through 8. And once you believe the gospel, receiving Christ's death, burial, and resurrection as payment for your sins, you are eternally saved, period. You are now the child of God, period. And he is your father. Everyone is either a child of God or a child of the devil. You may be the most sweet, honest, and kind person in your town, city, neighborhood, but you are still a child of the devil if you have never been born again by the Spirit of God, by faith in Christ Jesus. And you may be cranky, have a short temper, and be impatient, but you are still a child of God if you have believed the gospel. You just need to work on those things. You don't go to heaven because your good outweighs your bad. That's what the devil wants people to think. Because no one is good in God's eyes. No one. Isaiah 64, 6. James chapter 2, verse 10. We go to heaven because we have Jesus' righteousness. Romans chapter 4, verse 5 and 6. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. Romans chapter 10, verses 3 and 4. A demon's favorite activity is making religious people feel saved. Most religious people and religions have never been born anew by the Spirit of God, by the Word of God. The Bible is the seed, 1 Peter 1:23. If we place our faith in Jesus, the Christ, the only begotten Son of God, who died, was buried, and rose up 3 days later, then our sins are washed away by the precious blood of Jesus forever, period. 1 Peter 1:18 and 19. Here's some doctrines of the devils. These are things that can be influenced by those who are unsaved and saved. These are things that will be influenced in your mind if you're on drugs and alcohol. 1 Timothy 4:1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of demons and devils. Demons seduce people through false teachings. All of the talk of spirits meetings with New Age gurus are in reality demons. There's a guy by the name of Maitreya. It's saturated in demonic activity. Alice Bailey and Madame Blavatsky were all involved with demons. And Blavatsky founded Lucifer magazine in 1887, just 4 years before her death. The official publishing company of the United Nations began as the Lucifer Trust, but changed their name a year later due to the public outcry to Lucis Trust. You couldn't make this stuff up. Christians, we are not ignorant of Satan's devices and methods. So contrary to what some people think, there will not be one future religion during the end times. All of the mainstream religious denominations will maintain their distinctive identities, but they will continue to merge doctrinally to promote better cooperation, unity, and tolerance for each other. So this main religion, some believe Chrislam, or a worldwide one religion, will exist, but there'll be many other denominations that will be a part of it. They'll maintain their identity, but they'll still be part of it. So 1 John 5:19 and 1 John 4:4. And we know that we are of God, and the whole world lieth in wickedness. Ye are of God, little children, have overcome them, because greater is he, Christ, that is in you, than he, Satan, that is in the world. That's what can happen when you allow yourself to be addicted to drugs and alcohol. Sexual perversion. It's what can happen when you have something that comes into your life and takes a hold on you and has a stronghold on you and can reduce your walk with Christ to nothing, worse off than what it was before you even knew Christ. Now, I promised we'd get back to, you know, alcohol. Well, we're there. So let's define some key words in alcohol in the Bible. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 1, and chapter 31, verses 3 through 5. Wine is the Hebrew word pronounced yayin, and it means wine of every kind, fermented and unfermented. It's used 142 times in the Old Testament, and its meaning is determined entirely by its context. Most often, it is used of alcoholic wine. Now, strong drink, the Hebrew word is shikar, which comes from a root word which means to get drunk. It is a very intoxicating drink made from barley, honey, or dates. Now, because strong drink in biblical times basically was beer. Mocker equals scoffer. Raging equals a brawler and is deceived, to err or to go astray. It means to lie. And we're talking about Proverbs chapter 20, verse 1. Wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. So we're going to divide the Bible study here tonight, today, into two studies in reference to what we're going to go in with talk about alcohol. And there are examples in the Bible of those who have been deceived by strong drink, thereby becoming unwise. Well, who were they? Noah was deceived and became unwise. In Genesis chapter 7, verse 1, Genesis chapter 9, verses 20 and 21. And the Lord said unto Noah, come thou and all thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation. And Noah began to be a husbandman, and he planted a vineyard, and he drank of the wine, and was drunken, and he was uncovered within his tent. This is an instance in the Old Testament where the Hebrew word yayin is translated as fermented wine, for the Bible says, and he was drunken. So alcoholic beverage possesses the mind and causes an individual to be released of their own common sense. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18 says, And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, indicating that wine has the ability to control you just as the Holy Spirit does if you drink enough of it. In other words, wine can control you if you drink enough of it. You allow the Holy Spirit to control you if you drink enough of Him. Most folks today deny the fact that alcohol has the ability to impair the brain. But the Bible, as well as scientific study, proves otherwise. Noah became drunk, and he got naked. All too often, this is the case. How many of you women out there who are listening today remember the song, Tequila Makes Her Take Her Clothes Off? All too often, immorality and the lack of common moral sense is connected to the intake of fermented wine or alcohol, strong drink. One of the most vivid illustrations is found in Genesis 19, 30-38, concerning Lot and his two daughters. Lot went up out of Zoar and dwelt in the mountain, and his two daughters with him, for he feared to dwell in Zoar, and he dwelt in a cave, he and his two daughters. And the firstborn said unto the younger, our father is old, and there is not a man in the earth to come in unto us after the manner of all the earth. Here, basically, what she was saying is that when God had destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah and the other cities, and he dwelt in, and so the angels took Lot and his wife and his two daughters. The wife turned around, turned into a pillar of salt. So it's just Lot and his two daughters. And they took them to the city of Zoar. Once they were safe, angels destroyed the cities. But then, of course, these two daughters thought it was the end of the world. It was the end of their world where they lived. And they said, well, how are we going to carry on? What are we going to do? So they said, come, let us make our father drink wine, and we will lie with him, that we may preserve seed of our father. And they made their father drink wine that night, and the firstborn went in and lay with her father, and he perceived not when she lay down, nor when she arose. And it came to pass on the morrow that the firstborn said unto the younger, behold, I lay yesternight with with my father? Let us make him drink wine this night also, and go thou in and lie with him, that we may preserve the seed of our father. And they made their father drink wine that night also. And the younger arose and lay with him, and he perceived not when she lay down, nor when she arose. Thus were both the daughters of Lot with child by their father. The firstborn bare a son, and called his name Moab, the same as the father of the Moabites unto this day. And the younger she also bare a son, and called his name Benami, the same is the father of the children of the Ammonon unto this day. So you can see the consumption of alcoholic beverage certainly impaired Lot's wisdom by what his daughters planned. Secondly, we have Nabal. Nabal was deceived and became unwise. This is in 1 Samuel 25:36. And Abigail came to Nabal, and behold, he held a feast in his house like the feast of a king. And Nabal's heart was merry with him, within him, for he was very drunken. Wherefore she told him nothing, less or more, until the morning light. In the synopsis of 1 Samuel 25, verse 36, and 1 Samuel 25, in the context of the chapter of this biblical passage, Nabal certainly lived up to his name, which means churlish or foolish. Now the name of the man was Nabal, and the name of his wife Abigail, and she was a woman of good understanding and of a beautiful countenance. But the man was churlish and evil in his doings, and he was of the house of Caleb. 1 Samuel 25, verse 3. So not only was he churlish, he was also a man who consumed a lot of wine. The Bible says he was very drunken. As morning light dawned upon Nabal, Abigail told him how she saved his life from the hand of King David. It wasn't long after that that Nabal's heart died within him, and he became as stone. Simply put, he lost all purpose for living. And the Bible says 10 days later, the Lord smote him, and he died. It came to pass in the morning, when the wine was gone out of Nabal, and his wife had told him these things, that his heart died within him, and he became as a stone. And it came to pass about 10 days after that, the Lord smote Nabal, that he died. 1 Samuel 25, verses 37 and 38. What about Elah? Elah was deceived, and he became unwise. 1 Kings 16, 8, verses 8 through 10. In the 26th year of Asa, king of Judah, began Elah, the son of Baasha, to reign over Israel in Tisra, 2 years. And his servant Zimri, captain of half his chariots, conspired against him. And he was in Tisra, drinking himself drunk in the house of Azra, steward of his house in Tisra. And Zimri went in and smote him, killed him in the 27th year of Asa, king of Judah, and reigned in his stead. So the sad thing about this biblical passage is, more than anything, is that Elah was drunk and had no idea that his life was about to be taken. Alcohol had deceived him into believing that everything was okay. This is one of those great lies told by alcohol to its slaves, that everything seems to be better than it is, and it will be if you keep drinking it. Basically, you wake up and find out it's not. Perhaps this is why people drink away their sorrows and go to the happy hour at the neighborhood bar. It's all a lie. What about Nineveh? Nineveh, he was deceived and became unwise. This is found in the book of Nahum, chapter 1, verse 10. For while they be folded together as thorns, and while they are drunken as drunkards, they shall be devoured as stubble fully dry. Nineveh was at first a center of heathenism and ungodliness. God sent a prophet named Jonah to preach to them, and revival broke out. The Bible indicates in the book of Jonah that everyone in the city who was old enough to know their left hand from their right turned to the Lord. Everyone in the city either got saved or got right with God during the preaching of the service that Jonah gave. Jonah told them to repent or God would destroy them, and they repented. However, only 150 years after the greatest revival the world had ever known, a prophet by the name of Nahum prophesied against Nineveh once again. This time, there was no revival. This time, there was only judgment. But what was one of the main reasons that judgment fell this time? And Nahum chapter 1, verse 10 tells us it was because they were drunken as drunkards. Solomon, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit of God, knew full well what would destroy a king. Notice again his words in Proverbs chapter 20, verse 1 here. Wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. If a king can be deceived, that is, led astray because of wine, then surely the rest of us can be also. So I think it's pretty interesting to restate here that the word deceived also means a lie. Alcohol is a liar and will convince you that what it is telling you is the truth. The Bible says that whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. Perhaps this is why there is an old saying which says, you can never reason with the drunk. Why? Because they've been lied to. And rather than believe the truth, they choose to believe a lie. So as a Christian, you ought to have conviction, down to the depths of your soul, that alcohol is wrong. The Bible says that wine is a mocker and that strong drink is raging, and that anyone who believes their lies is not wise. So what about the Old Testament words for wine and strong drink? Yayin, which we talked about here just a few minutes ago, it means wine of every kind, fermented and unfermented. It's used 142 times in the Old Testament. And its meaning is determined entirely by its context. Most often it's used of alcohol, alcoholic wine. So there's numerous examples. What are the New Testament words for wine and strong drink? Onios. This is the general word used in Greek for wine and is equivalent to the Old Testament word yayin. Its meaning, like yayin, is determined by the context. Most often it speaks of fermented wine, but not always. Glucose, which is pronounced, glucose, G-L-E-U-K-O-S, glucose. This word speaks of wine that is beginning to ferment. Its usage in the New Testament proves without a doubt that it speaks of alcoholic wine. In sakira, this is a word used to describe a strong, intoxicating drink made from any sweet ingredients, including grain, vegetables, fruit, juice, or honey. It's used one time in the New Testament, in Luke chapter 1, verse 15, "For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost, even from his mother's womb." So what are the differences between old, new, and good wine? Old wine is aged wine, and it's very intoxicating. Luke chapter 5, verse 39, "No man also having drunk old wine straightway desireth new, for he saith, the old is better." New wine is expressed in two New Testament words or phrases. Onion, which is a neon, this is freshly squeezed juice and able to be fermented, and it's found this way: "Neither do men put new wine into old bottles, else the bottles break, and the wine runneth out, and the bottles perish, but they put new wine into new bottles, and both are preserved." It's found in Matthew chapter 9, verse 17. It's also in Mark chapter 2, verse 22, and you can find reference to it in Luke chapter 5, this is verses 37 and 38, which say basically the same thing. Glucose, this is the fermented sweet wine, and is used only in Acts chapter 2, verse 13. "Others mocking said, these men are full of new wine." So good wine, this is the juice without admixture of any kind. It is pure and unfermented and is used only in John 2:10. In the Greek, translated, "And saith unto him, every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. But thou hast kept the good wine until now." So then, how did Jesus refer to wine used at the Lord's Supper? Jesus always referred to the drink used in the Lord's Supper as fruit of the vine. He says, "But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom." Matthew 26, verse 29. "Verily I say unto you, I will drink no more of the fruit of the vine until that day that I drink in a new kingdom of God." Mark 14, 25. "For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come." Luke 22, verse 18. There is not one New Testament reference that teaches that the fruit of the vine used in the Lord's Supper should be fermented. In 1 Corinthians 11, chapter 11, verses 20 through 22, Paul rebukes the Corinthian people for coming to church and getting drunk. When you come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. For an eating, everyone taketh before other his own supper, and one is hungry and another is drunken. What have ye not houses to eat and to drink in? Or despise ye the church of God, the shame them that have not? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not. He then refers to the drink used during the Lord's Supper as the cup, quoting Jesus from the Bible passages concerning the Last Supper. So Paul here indicates that their drinking of fermented wine and their drunkenness brought shame to their local church there in Corinth. Unleavened bread represented his sinless body, and unfermented wine represented his sinless blood. What leaven is to bread, fermentation is to juice. So what kind of wine did Jesus make at the wedding in Cana? The story of Jesus' first miracle, turning water into wine at the wedding of Cana, is found in John 2, chapter 2, verse 1 through 10. Notice the words of the ruler of the feast in John chapter 2, verse 10. And saith unto him, Every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. But thou hast kept the good wine until now. Worse wine equals inferior wine, indicating that this was old, intoxicating, fermented wine. Good wine equals wine that was intrinsically good, that is, wine that was pure and free from fermentation or admixture. So the wine served by Jesus at the wedding of Cana was pure, unfermented grape juice. So does the Bible ever warn about drinking alcohol? Proverbs 21, wine's a mocker, strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived by it thereby is not wise. Proverbs 23, 29 through 35, who hath woe? Who hath sorrow? Who hath contentions? Who hath babbling? Who hath wounds without cause? Who hath redness of eyes? They that tarry long at the wine, they that go to seek mixed wine, look not thou upon the wine when it is red, when it giveth its color in the cup, when it moveth itself aright. At the last it biteth you like a serpent, and stingeth like an adder. Thine eyes shall behold strange women, and thine heart shall utter perverse things. Yea, thou shalt be as he that lieth down in the midst of the sea, or as he that lieth upon the top of a mast. They have stricken me, shalt thou say, and I was not sick. They have beaten me, and I felt it not. When shall I awake? I will seek it yet again. Translated into modern day language is that, man, I didn't feel it when they beat me up because I was too drunk. I lied down in the midst of the sea and I didn't even know I was on top of the mast. I was supposed to be in the hull of the boat and I woke up on top of the mast. And then you know what? When shall I awake? Well, I will seek it yet again when I do. I'm going to get drunk again. Proverbs 31, verses 4 and 5. It is not for kings, O Lemuel. It is not for kings to drink wine, nor for princes' strong drink, lest they drink and forget the law and pervert the judgment of any of the afflicted. So in other words, it makes them influenced to the matter that they do not think wisely. Hosea chapter 4, verse 11, whoredom and wine and new wine take away the heart. Habakkuk 2:15, woe unto him that giveth his neighbor drink, that puttest thy bottle to him and makest him drunken also, that thou mayest look on their nakedness. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18, and be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. How many women, you know, there was a poll that was taken here not too long ago, talked about alcohol. It's unprecedented the amount of alcohol that's being drank amongst college students. But what's even more unprecedented is the number of people that are getting, the number of women that are conceiving their children under the influence of alcohol. You stop and think about that one. Even a casual study of the scriptures surrounding the use of wine and strong drink in the Bible shows plainly that alcoholic wine and strong drink are not good. Paul recommended that Timothy use a little wine for his stomach. Drink no longer water, but use a little wine for thy stomach's sake and thine often infirmities. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 23. If indeed wine is a mocker, would Paul have recommended it to a young preacher? I think not. The wine that Paul recommended to Timothy was the strictly good wine that was not fermented. Modern-day studies in medicine have proven that pure grape juice is a healer of stomach infirmities. Solomon's own mother, Bathsheba, insisted that wine and strong drink were not good for those who intended to do the will and work of God. Without recommending wine and strong drink, she said, "Give strong drink unto him that is ready to perish, and wine unto those that be of heavy hearts. Let him drink and forget his poverty and remember his misery no more." Proverbs chapter 31, verses 6 and 7. So these scriptures can be compared to a statement like this made in our last Bible study that we were just talking about in the demonology here. Don't let them drink in your house. Send them to the bar down the street. It's not a recommendation, but a condemnation. And this is how Bathsheba meant it. So here's the bottom line, folks. And I hope you've been listening, because we're getting here to the end. Now, some of you are addicted to alcohol, and some of you are addicted to drugs. Some of you are addicted to your medical marijuana. You're addicted to marijuana in the recreational use. Some of you who proclaim to know Christ, you have demonic influences in your life, and you don't know how to get rid of them. We're going to try. We're going to do it. We're going to do it right now. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to confess the sins and then renounce pride, rebellion, and self-centeredness. All right? We're going to pray. And then we're going to break these chains that bind you. Are you ready? I want you to bow your heads. All right? And before we use this prayer, we're going to expel the spirits from yourself. And you'll have to stop sinning. Cut out the things of the world and serve God to prevent them from coming back in. And we're going to pray a protection of prayer. We're going to call it a warfare prayer. And you want to listen to it and pray every single day this prayer. All right, let's go first. Step one. We want to confess sins, then renounce pride, rebellion, and self-centeredness. Ready? Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins and rose again from the dead. I confess all my sins and repent. I forgive everyone who has hurt me. I transfer all pain, rejection, abandonment, betrayal, and abuse of the cross of Jesus Christ to the cross of Jesus Christ. Father, please forgive me. Father, I know that pride is an abomination to you. I renounce pride, rebellion, disobedience, stubbornness, and self-centeredness. I humble myself and come to you as a little child and ask for forgiveness and deliverance in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus Christ, I break and loose myself and my family from all curses caused by habits and charms, hexes, spells, jinxes, psychic powers, sorcery, witchcraft, love potions, psychic prayers, violence, trauma, physical bondages, mental bondages, incest, illegitimacy, abandonment, rejection, and divination in the family on the mother and father's side, going all the way back to Adam and Eve. I break and loose myself and my family from any vows I made, from any person or any occult or psychic sources, and any demons coming through the bloodlines. I cancel all invitations made to unclean spirits. Father, I break and renounce all evil soul ties that I have ever had with partners, close friends, relatives, engagements, cults, occult objects, dolls, figurines, junk food, cigarettes, drugs, movies, animations, TV shows, computer games, gambling, porn, masturbation, fornication, secular music. I renounce all these ties and declare them destroyed in the name of Jesus. I renounce, break, and loose myself and family from all of the religions, especially Roman Catholicism, Hinduism, Islam, Buddhism, Mormonism, Jehovah's Witnesses, New Age, and other religions. I also renounce unbelief, doubt, lies, fear, hatred, and anger. I bind and cast all out related spirits. I renounce, break, and loose myself from all demonic subjection to my parents or any human being, living or dead, who has dominated me in any way against the will of God. Thank you for setting me free. I command Satan to loose all natural resources, land, animals, money, the finances of people who owe us money, and all the things you've stolen from my family that are ours through the blessings of Jesus. Father, please send your angels to bring these things back to us. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Through the blood of Jesus, I am redeemed, and out of the hand of the devil, and all my sins are forgiven. The blood of Jesus Christ is cleansing me from all sin. I am justified and made righteous, just as if I had never sinned. I'm set apart for God. My body is a temple for the Holy Spirit, redeemed and cleansed by the blood of Jesus. I belong to Jesus now, body, soul, and spirit. His blood protects me against all evil. Satan has no more power over me, no more place inside of me. I renounce all evil spirits completely and declare them to be my enemies. Just as Jesus said, all these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. I am a believer, and in the name of Jesus Christ, I exercise my authority and expel all evil spirits. I command them to leave according to the word of God and in the name of Jesus Christ. Father in heaven, please send your Holy Spirit to fill us up in the name of Jesus. Father in heaven, I ask for legions upon legions upon legions of angels from heaven in the name of Jesus to station around us. Angels of the Lord, at Jesus' command, attack every unclean spirit in Jesus' name. I bind the principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness, and all the strong demons in the name of Jesus. I command all demons not to transfer, go exactly where Jesus wants you to go, and do not come back. I cancel all demonic assignments on this person. If you prayed that along with me, repeat each command as directed by the Holy Spirit and be delivered. Now let's pray for protection. Father, please make me a humble servant of people like Jesus Christ. I will push myself down so that God can lift me up. Remove my human understanding and wisdom and fill me with your wisdom and understanding. I'm a worm before you, O God. In accordance with your word, my righteousness is of filthy rags. I can't do good without you. Please have mercy upon me and help me change day by day to become more like Jesus Christ. I ask that you please send your ministering spirits to protect your people and all people and animals that would be sacrificed or cursed by occult practices. In the name of Jesus, I loose legions upon legions of angels to warfare, restore souls, protect believers, stop us from believing and agreeing with lies, and release breakthrough upon myself, my family, my friends, and the world in the name of Jesus. I loose the spirit of understanding and wisdom, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and fear of God upon himself and myself, family, and the world. I loose the spirit of power, the spirit of love, and the spirit of sound mind against the spirit of fear. I loosen the spirit of adoption to draw people to Christ. Somebody's on their knees right now. Father, please pour out your Holy Spirit to convict the world of sins and to soften hearts to see the truth. And above all, I pray for your will, Father, to be done on earth even as it is done in heaven. In Jesus' name, we pray today. Amen. Download this podcast. Keep it on your iPod or your iPhone. And when you feel like you want to go smoke a joint, or you want to get drunk, you pray that prayer again, on your knees, down before God, and do it as many times as it takes so that you can stand up on God's green earth. you can stand up with his power in your life to resist all of it, to never go back to it ever again. You need to prepare your heart. You need to bind the demons. You inflict a warfare on Satan. You loose angels to minister to believers and release the breakthrough. Then you loose God's seven spirits of the world. Ask God for his Holy Spirit and his will be done in your life. And see the power being increased by your prayer and by fasting. You need to try fasting 1 or 2 days a week. No food, just drink water. And pray. And watch what God does. The spirits and the curses will be broken. Pray for protection over yourself. Ask for a hedge of protection around yourself each and every day and around every family member. Ask for a hedge of protection for your children, your grandchildren, your mom, your dad, whoever it may be. Ask God to send his holy angels to protect them. Ask the Father to send someone to minister to them. You become that person and minister to your family. Rise up. Walk away from this life of drugs and alcohol and sexual perversion. All of it is encompassed within the influence of demonic activity that comes to you when you open up your mind to it. Thank you for tuning in. I hope this has helped you. And now that God knows your name, celebrate it. And now that you have the power of the Holy Spirit, celebrate it.
Shoot.